Okay, hello everyone. Today we are going to discuss about system software, which is chapter 20 in AS. And let's start with the objective first. What are we going to study and what needs to be done? Like we are going to study about the architecture of OS, how does it work, what are the functions at the from the back end, and we are going to discuss about virtual machine, memory management, and there are other things. During the lecture, there is going to be a short video as well. So hopefully, let me see if it works. Okay, and internally the mics work. So if not, then let me know. So let's start off with the purpose. All right, can you see the book, guys?
Yes.
Yes. Yes.
All right. Okay. All right. So OS. In short, basically kind of software which comes under the system software. Whenever I say or use this term system, it means that within the system, they're going to be operating system. Apart from that, they're going to be assemblers, compilers, and then the program. Hello? Ji, baat karo. जी हाँ जी हाँ मैंने देखी
अब तो रिकॉर्डिंग स्टॉप
ठीक है ठीक है ठीक है तो मैं आगे ले लेता हूँ चलो अच्छा जी ओके सॉरी ओके कमिंग बैक टू दी ओएस आई वाज सेइंग अंडर दी सिस्टम सॉफ्टवेयर देयर आर टू थ्री सॉफ्टवेयर दैट type of software that we count, starting off with the system software, then we have utility programs, and there are so many other things, right? Like assembler compilers comes under the system software category. Operating system again is a type of system software. In general, what is the purpose of these system software or operating system specifically? Like these software are basically they act as a mediator in between the user and the computer. So whatever the task that you are not able to comply through hardware, so this is the medium, this is where your operating system helps you out in making your task easier through hardware, through your system hardware. The basic purpose for any OS is like we have discussed, and I've highlighted some of the important things that we need to go through later on. But during the lecture, I'll just explain. See, this is the basic architecture of OS here. If you see how they are linked. On the top, you will have your hardware, printer, keyboard, I/O devices, this screen, and then their respective device drivers. And all of them, they are connected through CPU and memory. So this is a kind of a general overview of how these I/O devices are linked with each other within a system. And then later how these are linked with the operating system we are going to discuss. Here they have mentioned some of the data transfer rates, like here, like for the keyboard, 10 bit per second. The screen is 50 megabits per second. This is 5 Mbps. These are the data rate, the transfer rate from I/O devices, right? It's just a kind of description. You don't need to remember and memorize all these things. Next is we have the facilities. Now, if you remember, even in your O levels, if you have studied, obviously all of you have O level background. So you must have studied the function, the basic functions that are provided by the OS. Like for example, file management. We have
RAM management,
memory management. Yes, yeah. Multitasking, multi-programming, user interface. So there are so many things that are actually provided by the OS. And here they have specifically mentioned a thing called API. API, application programming interface. So what does it do? It actually helps you in creating a kind of a module, or let's say you're making a software, any software. You make any software, and if you need to use some of the utilities related with operating system, then you need to call those APIs in your own program. So these are kind of a built-in modules that you call in your main program just to access those utilities. For example, let's talk about File Explorer. Yeah, Javeri, have you used the File Explorer before? And obviously, so many times, obviously, must have used it, isn't it? Javeri, are you listening?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, I'm saying that, have you used Explorer, Windows Explorer, or any file management tool, right? Or even if you're using my computer, you're using my computer, then you can, you know, simply if you want to reuse this utility in your own program, which you're going to make later on in any language. So obviously then what you need to do is you need to call those utilities through APIs. So API itself is what? It's just a utility. It's just the module that can be accessed, which are available within the operating system, and you can call it in your own program so that your program can have full control over the operating system module.
Okay.
It's just a kind of a definition, and then let's just have a layered structure. There are two layered structures which we normally use here in the first one. Starting off with the user interface, because from your end, the one which you are seeing is what? It's like it's a user interface, huh? The one which you're using, because you are actually getting the interface. What is happening at the back end, you are not aware of anything. Because the operating system is handling all the things on your behalf. So in the front, on the top, you will have just interface. Like I right now, this is the interface. This is the screen which I'm having at the moment. Which I'm doing at the moment, right? So this is my interface. From your end, there is going to be different interface. But at the back end, of the interface, you will have the application programs. For example, here I'm opening this book. So at the back end, the program is what? This is opened in Adobe Reader, right? So this is going to be the application. And then at the back end, there's going to be utilities which are handled by the kernel. And kernel exactly is handled by whom? The hardware interface. So this is the hierarchy and the structure of a normal operating system, starting from the top to the lower management.
What is the kernel?
Kernel again is just a internal structure, basically who handles the hardware, which is very much related to the hardware. You can easily understand this structure by modular structure. Here, as we can see, this is the kernel, and he's the one who is going to deal with the hardware. But before that, it manages the memory, it manages the file, it manages the devices, it manages the schedule. So these are the four or five things that kernel is used to handle, right? And all of them, they're connected with the kernel, then kernel itself is basically connected with the hardware. All right. It's a part of OS. It's a major part of OS. This kernel thing. Is basically the major core component of an operating system. Okay, because as you can see here, it handles so many things at a time, right? And then at the back end, it is linked with your hardware, right? So this is the modular structure, which is more appropriate, more flexible, and easier to understand as well. Okay, and that's why it's called microkernel structure, right? So these are some of the diagrams through which you are able to understand how this operating system handles, right? And how the scheduler works. This is going to be our next topic, starting off with the high level scheduler, then there's a medium scheduler, and then there's a short term scheduler. Now, what is a scheduler? Scheduler, in normal terms, obviously, whenever you want to execute any task and on a specific time, you call a scheduler. You just like your kind of an alarm, okay, within the clock in your through your mobile. Okay, well, yeah, I want this to be done on this specific date and time. So these are the schedulers. You must have used the scheduler in your own systems, in your own maybe app, in your mobiles. So here, in terms of computer, the scheduler is basically handled by the operating system, but there are different types: high level scheduler, medium term, as well as the short term. Okay, how do you think works? What does it mean? Let's just have a look here. As you can see, program scheduler program controls the selection of a program stored on disk to be moved into main memory. Means that whenever we all know, whenever you load any program here, see, this is the disk. Nowadays, the program directly goes to the memory. From memory, it goes to the CPU. It can't jump directly from disk to CPU. So the scheduler, this is the control, right, through which you need to make sure that you want to access some data from the disk to the memory, and then from memory it goes to the CPU. So these are the three types of these three schedulers are utilized based on the type of program, right? Based on the type of program, we are going to discuss in detail later on. It's just an overview right now. This is the process states, which is very important. These type of questions they ask in normal A-level, normal leaders, you get these questions every year from this chapter. So that is the reason this chapter is very important. This is the core chapter for P3. Okay, you get at least one or two questions from this chapter. So try to understand the importance now. So move on to the process states. We move on to the process states. They are actually a kind of a structure here, as you can see. Five states defined for a process being executed. These are the five states through which a process is actually executed. But before discussing the processes, let me just explain some of the terms that we're going to use. Starting off the PCB. This is a process control block. What is this PCB? Process control block is just an area, it's a memory area, right? Where you actually receive the data for how and why, just to process the data. That's a kind of an area, a specific area that is assigned specifically for the within the memory to process any specific data.
So it acts like a memory, like just like RAM.
It is created. This area, okay. PCB area, is actually created within a memory.
Okay.
While any process is actually executed, I'll explain in detail how it is done. But for now, this is a block. It's just a block which is actually created within a memory. Simple.
Okay.
All right. Now, next is the transitions between the states. How it is done, when it is done. Let's start with the from scratch. By a new process arrives in memory and PCB is created. Let's say right now, I'll share the screen. I'll open the task manager on my screen. Obviously, you can't see that. Let me just share the screen. Now, can you see the screen? The task manager?
Yes. Yes.
What is happening right now? Yeah. Javeria, can you see it?
Yes.
Now, on the top, you see these percentage sign related with their component, like CPU is 41%. So it's occupied right now. Memory is occupied 60%. Disk is 13. mostly we are concerned with these. I have arranged it on the from the top to down here. As you can see, this sometimes Zoom is actually consuming more CPU consumption as compared to others, like Google Explorer, desktop. See, and then the sequence is changed one after another because the control is transferred to another component or unit. So it's not like a Zoom will always be on the top. No. If you see closely, see right now it's on the top, but sometimes it will. Let's wait and have a look. It will go down. I see Firefox comes up, and then again it goes down. So it will. I mean, this is not fixed. It's not constant that the software will always consume this much of CPU, this much of memory. It's going to change. It's render. It's dynamic. It's not static, right? It's going to change.
I think the higher percentage, the higher the percentage of the memory consumption, the higher will be the software, I guess.
But see, it all depends on memory or CPU, whichever comes. Right now, who's accessing? This Zoom is getting 127, and then the CPU is 25 and 24. So, but the point is, obviously, if CPU is accessing, if CPU is using this software, and the half percentage is higher, so if the memory will also be consumed, na? But here, you see, Firefox is consuming more memory as compared to the CPU, but it's not it's not 127 MB, it's more than that. It's like 1400. But based on the CPU, we have categorized all these numbers. I can change it, I'll change it top to down, bottom to up. I can change it from on this to memory or from memory point of view. But I can right now from my end, but the main concern is the CPU, obviously, from my case. So I would always link all the apps through CPU consumption. So coming back to the book again. All right, so whenever a process is created, or process arrives in a memory, a PCB is created. A PCB, which is process control block, is created whenever any process arrives at the memory within the memory. Is that clear, guys? Now, next is, this is our first normal procedure, and this is a very common one. Whenever the process, I open a software, I open any app, I open anything through the laptop or through computer or through any OS, it first goes to the memory. From memory, it goes from memory, it actually assigns a state, and this state is called ready state. So once the process arrives in a memory, we assign a state to that process, and that state is actually called ready state. That clear? Ready state. Second is a process is in the ready state is given access to the CPU by the dispatcher. Now in between, like here, from ready state to the running state, if you want to move, see, once a process in the ready state, this is the very first thing that that needs to be done by the internal architecture of the CPU, right? Like you assign a specific state to a process which is done, which you like to set based on ready state. Now the second thing that you need to be you need to understand is that we need to shift, or we need to move from this ready state to running state.
Running state.
And who does it? The dispatcher. Yes. The dispatcher, which is the placed within the CPU, it's just the job of the dispatcher to convert or to change the state of any process. Earlier, the state was ready, and then now we need to move it to running. So now we are changing from the ready state to the running state. So who does it? The dispatcher does it.
Okay. The dispatcher.
Exactly. And let's just have a look as well. Let me show you the diagram. No? So then you can have a proper. This is the process. This is a new process. Once it goes to the RAM, you have to assign what? A PCB. A PCB is created, and then after it's done, it has been assigned to the ready state. Now, The dispatcher will change the state of ready to running. You understand? The dispatcher will change the state from ready to running. Now, whenever it's running, na, this is I need to understand. Now, a process in the running state is halted by an interrupt. Achha, whenever you find this in a running state, what does it mean? Running, this is the area where CPU is actually processing this process. You understand? Again, I repeat. Listen carefully. When I said, when a process is changed from ready to running, right? So, running means that this is the area, this is the time where CPU is actually processing that process.
Okay.
Is it clear?
Yeah.
All right. So, yeah, this is the area, this is the specific area where CPU is actually processing it. Till now, till ready, the CPU is not involved. The CPU is not involved. But here, once it reaches the running state, this is the time where CPU is actually processing it. Okay?
Okay.
Now, if it's clear, we move on to the next point or next bullet, which states, process in the running state is halted by an interrupt. It returns to the ready state. Achha. There can be a situation when a process is in the running state, but due to an interrupt, it will again move to the ready state. Now, what is an interrupt?
So basically, an error or something.
Exactly. An interrupt could be anything.
Or basically, you can, or something that, you know, stops the program, basically.
Okay, yes, I come to that point. Yes, mostly, yes, you're right. Okay, yeah, if you're saying that when it returns to the ready state, okay, then why it is returned to the ready state? Because of the interruption, and interruption can be occurred through anything, through any disk error, which could be anything. There is not only one specific reason, could be more than one reason behind. But there are some IO interrupts as well. Like, for example, I say input A, right? And then I say input B, and the calculation says C equals to A plus B. So this calculation, the process of C will not be executed until and unless the process A and B both are done. Means the inputs are done. Yes. If none of the inputs are done, so obviously you can't calculate any kind of process.
Obviously you need an input in order to get an output.
Exactly. Without any input, you cannot process any data. You cannot process the formula. You cannot process anything. No? So yes. Just before that, they said in the second bullet, the next bullet in fact, process is going to be in the running state, cannot progress until some event has occurred. It changes to the waiting state. Because now here, if you see the diagram, if a process is in the running state, there are only, actually there are three options. Either it can go back to the ready state, or it should go, or should go towards the waiting area. And then if it's in the waiting area, it goes to the ready, and then from ready it goes to the running. You see the cycle? Understand the cycle? Once a process is in the running state, either it will go towards the ready state again, which is the previous state, or it will go to the, or it will move towards the waiting state, or it will terminate. Termination will be occurred, or termination will be only done once the process is done. By once this process is over, once this process is over, it will be terminated. If not, then it is going to be two conditions. Number one, whether it go it will return it to the ready state or it will go to the waiting state. Now for the waiting state, they have you know, here they have mentioned this waiting state. A process in the running state cannot progress until some event has occurred, that is IO. I have given the same example just before, that once, if let's say if a process is waiting for some inputs, like C equals to A plus B, if I say C equals to A plus B and you need to input A and B both, and you haven't taken A and B both till now, so what will happen? It will change it to the waiting state, or in other words, they also call it suspended or blocked state. So this waiting area can also be considered as a blocked state or a suspended state.
So the operating system or the whole scenario is waiting for an input in order to get an output.
This, we are talking about only one process, by the way.
Okay.
I am talking about a single process. Listen, CPU cannot process more than one process at the same time.
Okay.
We need to understand this. Let's assume, earlier I have shown you the task manager, na? What was the reason of showing those task manager? The reason behind that was very simple. The task manager is basically responsible to show you maybe which is the current task being held or being processed by the processor. You see, at one time, only one process can be only processed by the CPU. You cannot jump or you cannot process more than one processes at the same time.
Okay.
Yeah. We say, bhai, whenever I say, bhai, a CPU is a multitasking machine or operating system allows you to do multitasking. You can perform 2-3 tasks at one time, no problem. I can listen to the music while I'm typing. Right, this is multitasking. But internally, what happens is that the CPU assigns a kind of a millisecond to a single process, and then it jumps to the second process, and then third process. This is the cycle which actually works in the backend.
Okay.
It allocates 0.00001. Let's say I'm assuming, I'm not giving the actual figures, but assume that it will assign 0.0001 second to task 1. Then it moves on to task 2. Again, it will assign 0.0001 second to task 2, and then 0.002 task 3. And the cycle goes on and on and on and on. And you will not notice that, because it's so fast that you won't able to. And you will feel that all the things are actually working in the same time. But actually, it's not. In reality, it's not. The CPU will only process one thing at a time.
Okay.
Now you understood?
Yes.
So here, when once a process is in the block state, it means that it is waiting for some input or output, or maybe some any other thing, right? And a process in the waiting state is notified that an event is completed, it returns to the ready state. Also, whenever the waiting state is over, the process has a built-in feature that it will update the CPU. Okay, I'm done. All the related tasks are done. So I don't need to wait anymore. So the CPU will make sure, okay, once you are done, so you should move towards the ready state. And from ready state, again, it goes to the running state. And from running, obviously, if there is some waiting, then it will go to waiting. Otherwise, it will be terminated.
Okay.
Okay.
Yeah, this is what they said. A process in the running state completes execution, it changes to the terminated state. That's it. I hope it is clear. The concept clear?
Yeah. Yes.
All right. There's a thread. There's a term that we use, thread. We have used a process, PCB, and a thread. PCB already said, what is a PCB? A block is, whenever a process arrives to the memory, it's a kind of, there's a block, it's actually a block has been created within the memory and for that specific process. And then later on, whatever the tasks are done, I've already explained the states of any single process, how it is executed, what needs to be done. And then the thread, it is possible for a process to be separated into different parts for execution. Okay, I split a process. When I split a process into different subsections or into different parts, so those parts, those single parts are actually known as threads.
Threads.
Yes.
Sir, can you give an example of a thread?
Yes, I'll give you an example. For example, let's say I'm right now opening this file. I've opened already opened this file. This is my PDF, computer science 960 PDF file, right? Now this file internally within the I'll show you the task manager again. Let's have a look. Can you see it?
Yes.
So right now this process Zoom, right now it's on the top. It's consuming 36 or 37%, right? So this process is actually, if I click again, it has sub processes as well. If you see here, the first part is consuming 23 or 24, and then there's 16 and 8. 15 plus 9, how much? 16 plus 9, how much? See, these are the overall.
25.
Exactly.
Okay.
So okay, these are the sub processes of a single process, right? A process, whenever it's loaded in the memory, it is actually split into different processes. So that split process or section of the process will be considered as a thread.
Okay.
You got it?
Okay.
Yes.
So it just as they haven't discussed in detail about the threads, but actually in programming we control most of the languages they give control towards the threads as well, and you can perform so many things using these threads, by the way, once you start with the programming. But here, not in your A levels, and I'm talking about in advanced later on the team. So it's your career for becoming a software engineer, then later on you need to work on these threads as well. Okay, here now after the thread, this is again the old topic that you must know about interrupts, buffer. Remember interrupts?
Yes.
Now we already know that there's a very basic definition of any interrupt. Like, what is an interrupt, by the way, if I ask you?
I'll go with the answer. An error occurred in a program that halts the process. The process.
Just because of the error, it's not only error. Interrupt could be anything. Interrupt can be played by anything. It's not about only error. Or could be anything. It's a signal. It's a signal. Every interrupt has a signal. Every IO device has its own interrupt. Like keyboard has an interrupt, like board has an interrupt. Every device has its own interrupt. Right?
Okay.
During the error. Now here they are specific. They are specifying the errors. They are not discussing in general. In fact, they are only using the term errors, because there are some interrupts, not all interrupts. They have mentioned that specifically, that there are some interrupts which are actually caused by errors. Like, for example, hard disk is fully occupied. Now, if hard disk is full, then you'll get an error. If a paper is jammed in a paper in your printer, then you'll get an error. So these are the interrupts that are actually caused by the errors, right? So that prematurely terminate a running process. Otherwise, there are two reasons for interrupt. Like this one, they said specifically to yes, due to error, the process who is in a running state can be terminated. Agreed?
Yes, sir.
Right. Apart from that, there are other reasons as well. Number one, processes consist of alternating periods of CPU. Now, what does it mean? It means that there could be, like I've given an example, I've already given an example. See, there could be an IO interrupt. Means that a process is relying on any other input to be done, then only it will process further. So because input is also an interrupt, output is an interrupt, an input. Once you've given an output, this is an interrupt. So this is what they are saying. A process consists of alternating periods of CPU usage and IO usage. IO takes far too long for the CPU to remain idle, for waiting for it to complete. The interrupt, see, but if it's taking too much of time, then obviously CPU needs to wait. Na, ke bhai, okay, I'll wait for the input, then I will move to the next task. So this should not happen. This should not happen for this reason. Internally, for the interrupts, this is the mechanism that they adopt. What does it do? They change their state from running to waiting state. Why are they doing this? Just because they don't want to waste the time of a CPU. This process is going to be in the waiting state. So you can continue with your own work. You don't need to be dependent on this process. And this is what they're saying. The interrupt mechanism is used when a process is in the running state, makes a system call requiring an IO operation, and has to change to the waiting state. Is that clear? So we already discussed it earlier. We just kind of an interrupt. They are linking those process things with an interrupt. Next is the scheduler. The scheduler decides to halt the process for one of the several reasons. The scheduling algos. Now, I told you in the beginning, before coming to these process states and all that, there is a scheduler. There is a scheduler. Scheduler does what? Scheduler is basically used to execute. It executes a specific task on a specific time based on a scheduling algorithm. Based on a scheduling algorithm that we are going to discuss later. But all of a sudden, if a task comes within a queue, and then it joins the processing. So why do we need to use this? Because of the scheduler, because we already told the scheduler, okay, on this and this time, you have to run this task. Just an example. So scheduler is also kind of an interrupt. First reason was error. Second reason was the IO usage based on the input output. And then the last one is your scheduler. Scheduler decides to halt the process. Why they halt the process? It could be more than one reason. Maybe that there is long-term scheduler, there's a mid-term scheduler, there's a short-term scheduler that we're going to discuss later. Right now, let's start with the scheduling algorithms. What type of scheduling algorithm does a CPU actually process or involves? There are two types of scheduling algos. Number one, preemptive and non-preemptive. A preemptive algo is one basically which we know it is going to start from this end and it's going to end on this end. Like, we already know the algo itself, this is the algorithm, this is the scheduling that we know it should start from this end at this point and should end to this end. We already anticipate that. We already know this is going to happen. So the algorithm that we already know, this will occur based on all our programming. They are actually those algorithms are considered to be preemptive. Non-preemptive are those algorithms which we are not anticipating, which we don't know, but they can occur at any time. But instead, we are going to discuss how, and let's start with the preemptive algo. The preemptive algo can halt a process that would otherwise continue running undisturbed. If an algo is preemptive, it may involve prioritizing the processes. Now here, they are explaining about the fact. Ek one, just hold on. Ye to kitchen ki hai, window zara band karna, ek second. Aur yahan pe tape lagana, agar tape hai to. Okay. It's a coming back again. Okay, sorry about that. Okay, Prasa. So in preemptive algorithm, what happened is that it will halt. It can halt a process anywhere. You know, it can just stop it. Like why? Because we already know. Okay, it will halt the ongoing process because of maybe there is some input required. Maybe some output is required. But we already know in this algorithm, we already know what is going to happen. We knew that. You know, we know from the very first day, okay, bhai, this is going to happen. Why? Because we are the one who is making the program. Na? So while making the program, we know okay, bhai, where is the interrupt, where kind of scheduling needs to be done. So if in this case, like say, if an algorithm is preemptive, it may involve prioritizing the processes. Now, why they are saying this? Because just like in schooling, if you remember the schooling concept, if not, then I'll explain it again. No issue. In most of the process, some processes have high priority, and in some processes, they are considered as a very low priority.
But
for the preemptive algorithms, the algorithms could be handled in such a way that it involves the prioritizing the processes. We can change it to higher priority or we can change it to lower priority. This can be done. This is possible in only preemptive algorithms. Okay? Any algorithm which is considered to be preemptive can be used for changing their priority later on. Okay. The simplest possible algorithm is first come first serve. This is known as you should tell me which is it. What do you call this algo? First come first serve.
Whichever comes first.
Stack.
No. Not stack is not. It's the reverse. It's a queue. It's not a stack.
Oh, sorry. Queue. Yeah.
First come, first serve. First FCFS, first come, first serve is a queue structure. Right?
Okay.
This algorithm is very preemptive, right? It's preemptive, na? You already know, okay, bhai, this will come first and then the second process will come after that, the third process will come after that. So, bhai, if we are not aware of any predefined algorithm, if you're not sure of any algorithms, what will come first and what will come after that? And they use this queue structure, and this queue structure is actually applied where in this non-preemptive process or algorithm. How? Let's just discuss in detail. FCFS is a non-preemptive algorithm and can be implemented by placing the processes in a FIFO queue. Okay, it will be very inefficient if it's the only algorithm employed, but it can be used as part of a more complex algorithm. Acha. Here, what they're saying is, hey, listen, I told you, whenever a process is placed in a CPU or is executed within a CPU, a specific time is allocated to a specific process. Remember?
Yes.
So in simple words, a time slice is allocated to each process. And based on that time slice, it will execute accordingly. If I say 0.002 second will be assigned to this process, so it will only take that time of that specific time for processing that process. Otherwise it will move on to the next process, and then again as soon as it reaches to the same process, it will again every time it will assign this time of CPU 0.0002 second, whatever. So here, if you see, a round robin algo, this is a kind of it's a name given to this algorithm. Don't worry about this name, okay? Just a name. There's no term, there's nothing like that. Round robin, it's just a name. name of the algorithm, which is basically used to allocate a time slice to every process and is therefore preemptive. Agreed?
Hmm.
Bhai, if I know, na, if I allow you to, if I say, ke, bhai, okay, this process number one will have 0.001 second, process two will have 0.002 second, third process will have 0.001 second. So we already know ke, bhai, what time of a CPU will be used for that specific process, because this is preemptive.
Yes.
Right? So we can use round robin algorithm, you can use any other algorithm, but here in the book they have used this specifically, so you have to make sure that you write those names just to get good marks, okay?
Okay.
In exam. Achha, because a process will be halted when its time slice has run out. Yes, obviously. Once the time slice has run out, then obviously it will move on to the next process.
Yes.
So it can be implemented as a FIFO queue. FIFO queue, first in, first out. It can be implemented as first in, first out queue. For example, the CPU doesn't know, okay, bhai, okay, which process will come first or which process will come in the second. So whoever will come first will get this much of time slice.
Okay.
Whoever will come second will get this much of time slice. Whoever comes on the third position will get this much of time slice. So this is what they are saying. This is what they are saying. Okay. So it normally does not involve prioritizing the processes. You know, here in this, in the queue structure, in the queue structure, there is no such priority.
Obviously.
Everyone comes and goes. Everyone comes and goes. As in, like, the process has been assigned, a process has been assigned based on time slice, and the structure follows is basically kind of a queue structure. So whichever will come first will be assigned a time slot, and that's it. So there's no priority. Within a queue, I can't say anyone, ke, bhai, you have to come in the front, no, you go to the back, no. No, it's not like that. We have to follow a queue, we have to follow the standard, so we have to start from the first come, first serve, till the end. From first and last. In second, they have mentioned how if separate queues are created for processes of different priorities, then each queue could be scheduled using a round robin algorithms. So here they are saying ke bhai, if there are, if you separate the queues from more than one queue, if you separate a queue within a queue, there's a queue within a queue, and then you again make another queue, you separate one queue within a queue, you select all those process and make another queue. So you can do that, but again, then you need to based on round robin algo, round robin algorithm. But again, this is preemptive, na? This is preemptive. We already know, okay, what is going to happen. Now here they are priority based scheduling. Now which are very obviously they are very complex, because you, how do you know, okay, why this has more higher priority than others? So you need to make sure that you follow a proper algorithm for assigning the priorities. So here what they're saying is, one reason for this is that every time a new process enters the ready queue or when a running process is halted, the priorities for the process may have to be re-evaluated. Yes.
Obviously.
This is self-explained. Obviously, when the state has been changed from running to ready or from ready to running, whatever, or if it has been waiting. If it's in the waiting state, so their priorities have to be re-evaluated. You can't just use the same priority as you have used earlier. So again, like I said, the criteria which are required for assigning their priorities is these four major bullets, starting off with number one. Estimated time of process execution, estimated remaining time for execution, length of time already spent in the ready queue, whether the process is IO bound or CPU bound. So these are the criteria which are actually considered for placing a kind of a priority for any process. More than one of these criteria might be considered. Yes, it's not only once. Okay, you can apply more than one as well for any process. and then based on the criteria you evaluate and you check whether you want to change the priority and how you want to change the priority based on these criteria.
Mm-hmm.
Is that clear?
Yeah.
Some yes. processes require extensive IO, like for example, printing wages slip for the employees. This is very little CPU usage, so it makes sense to limit it to a higher priority so that the small amount of CPU usage can take place. This is very purpose example, you know. So you have to also consider if you are printing up wages, so every time it will wait, it will take a queue. Okay, I need to wait, and then because printing needs to be done. So this is an output interrupt. So this is something that we need to understand. Here, our next topic is basically related with the memory management, which is very important. And I can simply explain this by through a video specifically. Now let me check if this is working or not. Let me just open the video for you. Can you guys hear this? Ami, guys, are you hearing?
Can you play?
Huh?
Yes.
Can you play?
Okay, I'll play again. G, everyone, can you hear the sound?
Yes. Yes,
all
yes.
Right. All right, good, good. So just be attentive. Because these are the different type of memory management scheme that we want to discuss. So we'll discuss again later on, but just be focused, okay? Just focus on the video, okay? Thank you. Mm. मैं तो मैंने टेप लगा था अभी हाथ क्या करो तो पता चले जाके बदबू कौन सा है टेप लगाओ भले हो so I hope that it's a very nice video related with the memory management specifically. Javedia, did you get the concept?
Yes, sir, but can you email this video?
There's no need to email. It's already, I'll share the video now. I am not going to email anything now. Whatever the video we are going to make, I'll upload it on my YouTube channel, like I said earlier. So you just go through, I'll upload it like within 10, 15 or half an hour. After half an hour, after the class, I'll upload the video on the channel. You can go through it. Okay?
Okay.
So whatever we are discussing, it's recorded. So this is a help. This is a kind of a help. And the others one from other colleges. So what I'll do is I'll share it with them as well. Okay? So now the virtual memory I discussed here by the Sean, what he's saying, like, you know, virtual memory is a part of the memory that can be created within the hard disk. If you fail, obviously if the RAM is full, so obviously you need a second backup. For the backup, obviously, what SSD or could be HDD. Both can be used. Anyone can be used for making a virtual memory. And here they have used the same old thing, the thing that we have discussed here. Specifically virtual memory paging mechanism that allows the program to use memory addresses then are available in main memory. And where does it apply? They apply in the hard disk. So whatever you've gone through the video, it's actually been discussed here in this paragraph. Okay, na? And they have also discussed the approaches, the advantages and disadvantages here. Advantage of virtual memory is very large program can be done when a large amount of memory is unavailable. Another advantage, only part of a program needs to be in memory at one time. Index table for a database could be free permanently in memory. Yeah, these are some of the advantages, but moving on to the disadvantages, which is disk thrashing. Disk thrashing is what? When part of a process on one page requires another page which is on a disk. See, you're getting it? One page is on the memory and one page is on the hard disk. So which page needs to be loaded? When the page is loaded, it's almost immediately required the original page again. This can lead to almost pre-partial loading and unloading. Because once page is in the RAM, one page is in the hard disk, so obviously you need time to access all these at a time. So this is going to be a part, and this is known as disk thrashing.
Okay.
Our last topic for today's class is virtual machine. This is going to be our last topic. Okay. What is a virtual machine? Any idea?
It's something kind of, it's hard to explain, but I do get it.
Virtual machine, say they don't get confused with virtual memory and virtual machine. Okay, these two are different. Okay, understand this. So when I say this virtual machine now, I mean I can install more than one operating system on my computer through this concept through this architecture. But let's say if I want to install Ubuntu as well as Windows in my system, Linux or Xenix is a kind of a, there are so many other operating systems that you want to run. I can also install Macintosh, right? Mac on my Windows. And I can run both at the same time through a virtual machine. So this is possible. The point is this, everything is possible. Nothing is impossible, right? But how it is done, this is what you're going to study here. Through this architecture, if you see the logic structure, the programs for a virtual machine 1, VM1, and the program for virtual machine 2, these are the two. This is operating system 1, this is operating system number 2. Operating system kernel for virtual machine 1, operating system kernel for virtual machine 2. See, a kernel is linked with the application program we have discussed earlier. And then there is a virtual machine scenario, the system which is in between the hardware and the virtual machine implementation software. This is the software which allows you to install more than one operating system on one computer. through this logical structure. Okay.
Mm.
And here they have also explained the principle of a virtual machine is that a process interacts directly with a software interface provided by the operating system. The kernel of the OS handles all the interaction with the actual hardware of the machine. See, this has the different kernel, it has a different kernel, they are handling different hardware. The hardware is almost the same, but kernels are different.
Mm.
So they are, in short, the software interface provide for the virtual machine provide an exact copy of the hardware. So they both of them will get the same copy of hardware, and by this way they are able to handle these hardware buttons. This is the structure. This is all theory, beta. This is all theory. You have to learn the structure, learn this internal architecture as well. The only thing that we need to discuss here: advantage and disadvantage. Right. What is the advantage of this approach? You can obviously work more than one. You can work on more than one operating system at one time, isn't it? This is a kind of an advantage, na? Acha, why do we use it? But there are some problems, na? For example, if I am running my company ABC, assume, right? And my company is using an old operating system, let's say Windows 8, and the software for my company, the software which I'm using for my company was actually developed in the old operating system environment. Right? So if it is used by another it was made for another operating system, so it's going to be difficult for me to use in the updated operating system, let's say Windows 10.
Yes.
So obviously. Windows 8 software Depends. Let's say I'm just giving an example. Just an example. Let's say, my software was developed in Apple.
Taking
an Apple system, and I also want to use Windows. So what should I do? I have then obviously there's no other way. I'll have to rely on the virtual machine. The virtual machine simple. I made the virtual machine, I can use both of these operating systems at one time. I can switch from one operating system to another, simple word, right? So by this way, I can use my old software. I can also use my new softwares, which I have used and which I have made for an updated operating system. These are some of the advantages that now the companies they get. And this is the reason they use this virtual machine thing. But what's the drawback? The major drawback is the resources. The resources will be used by both of the operating systems. So obviously once the resources are used by everyone, so it's going to be very difficult to handle. In other words, the memory, RAM. RAM will be used in both of the cases. So obviously the hardware issue is going to be the major one. And here they also mentioned this. The time and effort required for implementation, first thing. Another is the fact that implementation will not offer the same level of performance that would be obtained on a normal system. Yes. Then you have to sacrifice some of your thing. The system speed will not be at the will be more that appropriate as what you were getting it earlier. So the performance, the system performance will obviously be affected. And by this way, I can say very simply, this is going to be a drawback sometimes. But if you are okay with it, if you feel I can just compensate that, so then there's no issue. Then you can move on to you can use these both of the operating system. No issue.
Okay.
So just go through the lecture. If you have any questions, you can call me later on. Okay, and. Meantime, you can also study your previous lectures and the homework which I gave you. Okay, so let me just stop the video first.